thanks for coming, everybody. I think I know pretty much everyone in the room. My name is Dave Coyne. I work for the Cape Cod Cooperative Extension. And so, as you are aware, I work with all the towns on solid waste and recycling issues. And so pay-as-you-throw is obviously a big topic for the Cape, which is why you're all here on a cold Saturday morning. Help yourself with some coffee in the back. I've been told it tastes like mud. It's so strong.
It's great. Espresso.
Espresso. So this is all part of my strategy to keep you alert. But we have a great presentation today. We have DSM Environmental here, who's a solid waste consulting firm. They've worked all over the country with municipalities on a number of different solid waste issues. They'll talk a little bit more about their specific expertise. And they're here through funding from the Mass Recycling Challenge, which has sponsored them to go around and do workshops for municipalities throughout Massachusetts to try to increase recycling, to encourage towns to consider pay-as-you-throw, or what we're trying to call SMART, for Save Money and Reduce Trash. That's the new acronym. So we're trying to spread the word that it can be a savings. I know all of you are very well versed in pay-as-you-throw because you've worked on this in your towns. And I think we're just starting to see the results of some of the towns that have switched to pay-as-you-throw. Obviously, we have Sandwich, who started 2 years ago. They've had a great program. They've been able to reduce their trash by 50%. And then Brewster and Wellfleet just started this past year, past couple of months. I just got the numbers this past week from Wellfleet. First 3 months, trash is down by 36%, and recycling is up by 66%. Compared to the same months last year. And then in Brewster, trash is down by 55%, and recycling's up by 33% compared to the same amount of time last year. So those are really, really early numbers. We haven't even gone through summer yet. But I think it's encouraging. It's an encouraging sign, and we'll have to wait and see and continue to monitor it and see how many of the residents decided to stay with the program. So that'll be a big factor to figure out how people are using the program. Whether or not they've decided to go to a private hauler. So those are going to be important numbers to look at as we go forward, and then see how the summer residents respond to the program as well. So we have some encouraging numbers, but I also know there's a lot of concerns and questions about the program from residents, and it's been on the papers, it's been on the radio, and so I thought it was important to get a group together and talk about the latest and greatest information on pay-as-you-throw, have a chance for the people who are going to make these decisions in the towns to ask questions and have all the information that you need to make your decisions. So that's my brief introduction. I'm just going to turn it right over to Natalie and Ted from DSM, and they're going to run us through this workshop.
Great. All right. Well, thanks for having us down. You say it's cold down here, but I spent the night up on Mount Mansfield a few nights ago, and it was 5 below, and I went to the top at dawn, and it was 2 below, and the wind was blowing, it was beautiful. So this feels like kind of balmy, and I stayed down here.
It was 10 this morning.
Yeah, 10, that's warm. But we're up in Vermont, but we work all over the country, and we've worked all over the world, and we're here to talk about saving money and reducing trash through unit-based pricing. And this is a smart board, and we'll see how smart I am in using it. Right.
So far, so good.
Yep. You have to be a smart person to use the smart board. All right. Here we go. Voila. Workshop objectives. We're here to talk with all of you about first the nuts and bolts, but also the barriers to implementation. Perhaps some of you have already experienced these talking with your public officials or talking with the public about why you would or wouldn't advance unit-based pricing. Some of your programs have been around for a long time. I know you've got some great recycling programs on the Cape, but maybe some of them need updating. Maybe you have stagnant or maybe even falling recycling rates. What do you want to do about those? How would you use unit-based pricing to work on increasing recycling? And also, part of all the work we do is how do you develop more cost-effective solid waste and recycling programs? I want this to be an interactive discussion. Ted does as well. So feel free to interrupt me as I get into the meat of the conversation. We don't want to just be talking heads up here, all right? We also want to talk about grants. We'll do that at the end. What technical assistance is available after today to help you continue to work on this? This isn't just today, come and learn. This is today, come and learn. What are you going to do with this information? what can you do back in your own communities? How can you work together at advancing recycling and hopefully advancing using unit-based pricing to do so? This is how we're going to break up this morning. There's coffee and snacks in the back of the room. Feel free to get up while we're talking. We'll also take a break about midway through, and then we'll close with questions and give you contact information, and then we're here to answer questions individually with you as well. And I'm up here to entertain you. Are you smart for it?
I can click it.
No, I'm going to get this. All right, so now this is when you guys have to start working. All right, so what we want to do is, I know you signed up, but if you can just really quickly give us your name, you can just give us your first name if you want, what town you're from, and why you're attending, you know, maybe really quickly what you hope to get out of this morning. I think this will help Ted and I to maybe change our comments a little bit and address what you're here for. So do you mind if I start with you?
Not at all.
Okay.
Michelle Crimes, Dennis. I'm with the, what's been called so far, the Pay-As-You-Throw Task Force. And I'm attending to learn more and find more about how we can access additional information for our town.
Great. Hope we can help with that.
Wayne Bergeron, Selectman and Dennis. Very much for Pay-As-You-Throw. And I'm looking for ideas to help sell it to the community.
Good. Good to hear that.
John Allman, Dennis.
Yeah.
It'll be a routine. Same thing. Pay Your Throw Committee, very pro Pay Your Throw.
My name is Kalia Pink. I work for Barnstable County on the Hazardous Materials team. I'm on the team with Dave, so I'm here to support him and learn more about what he's up to.
I'm Peggy McAloon, Dennis, also a member of the Pay Your Throw Task Force, as it was called, and quite interested in the whole idea.
Remo Vito, Pay-As-You-Throw Task Force from Dennis. Basically just trying to get more information on Pay-As-You-Throw.
Al Ryan, Dennis, Pay-As-You-Throw Task Force. We have everybody.
Dennis is here.
I really wanted to get some information on how we get the information to the people and break through some of the misinformation that's out there, and that's really the whole story.
I'm Heidi Schott, Selectman and Dennis, and I liaison to this committee, which is very interesting, and here to learn more also.
Great.
Jack Antonio from the town of Dennis, sanitation foreman for the transfer station, and I'm here to help support this committee.
Sounds like good representation from this committee, from Dennis. Is anyone here not from Dennis?
I'm Ann Kennedy, not from Dennis. A town councilor from Barnstable, looking to get some information, bring back to the other councilors.
Great.
I'm Ruth Brazier from Falmouth. So far, we haven't persuaded Falmouth to look favorably on Pay-As-You-Throw, but what I'm particularly interested in is how one deals with the summer population. We have big increases in summer population, and we don't seem to communicate with them very well on recycling or anything else to do with trash.
Big challenge on the Cape, I'm sure, for a lot of communities.
John Waterbury, I'm from the Falmouth, and I'm on the Board of Health, here to learn.
Great.
I'm Steve Rafferty, I'm also from Falmouth, and I'm also on the Board of Health, and I'm also here to learn.
Annie Sherwood, Board of Health in Brewster, and Recycling Committee. I would like to know how to support the community as far as recycling after the fact, so that they're not so intimidated by, you know, what am I going to do with this tea bag, or what do I do with this juice carton?
Yeah, I'm Richard Fishman, I'm from Truro. When I lived in Wellfleet, I worked with these guys behind me on the Pay-As-You-Throw committee there. I'm very interested in getting it put in place in Truro, and I particularly want to know how towns that have seasonal populations can deal with it with renters and stuff.
Okay.
I'm Harry Turcanian, and I'm the town administrator in Wellfleet. I'm Paul Pilcher. Paul Pilcher, selectman in Wellfleet, and I'm interested in finding out how we're going to deal with our public meeting coming up in 10 days.
10 days, wow. We'll be there for you.
Thank you.
I'm John Morrissey, a selectman in Wellfleet.
I'm Lydia Vivante on the Recycling Committee in Wellfleet, and look forward to sharing some of the things we've learned.
Thank you for coming.
I'm Janine Delaney with Mass DEP. I'm Dave's counterpart on the South Shore. Currently, I'm working with three towns who are on the verge of, well, actually, one has already voted to implement pay-as-you-throw. And I'm here today to learn more, to hear some of the questions here from town officials. Will help me with my towns.
Great. Well, thanks for coming, and feel free to share anything that you have to join in about some of the towns that you're working with.
Will do.
I'm Kate Krebs. I'm not from Massachusetts. I'm with the Mass Recycling Challenge that's funding this type of outreach and technical assistance, and have been a long time recycling advocate all over the country. So I came to see how it works when groups are brought together, and what the questions are, what the challenges are, and what kind of information that you need. So.
And Kate, who is modest, was executive director for the National Recycling Coalition for 8 years or so. So maybe you've heard her name. Any of you have been in recycling for a long time.
Thanks.
I'm Andrea Aldana from the East Ham Recycling Committee. We're planning to look at pay-as-you-throw in 3 years, so I'm just here to get information and report back.
My name is Anna Mensa. I'm an AmeriCorps Cape Cod member, volunteering on the Cape. I live in Wellfleet, and I'm here to find out how the pay-as-you-throw is working in all the Cape Cod communities, and maybe send this information to my other members.
So you're running that meeting in 10 days?
Yeah.
They want to give you a challenging job, right?
Yeah.
Sir? I'm Paul Caniff. I'm from the town of Barnstable. I'm basically an interested citizen. I'm on the Barnstable Board of Health and the Barnstable Public Works Commission.
Thank you for coming.
My name is Richard Ulrich. I'm Barnstable's energy coordinator, and I and the town's Renewable Energy Commission have been looking at this issue probably for at least 3 years now, and certainly during all of our research, we determined that without exception, pay-as-you-throw, or the concept of unit-based pricing, was the most effective way to reduce a town's solid waste stream. So I'm here essentially today to learn how to get these programs implemented, how to convince my town council, town councilors who are here, that it's a good idea, how to convince the community that it's a good idea as well.
Great. I'm Sarah Cushing. I'm a town councilor in Barnstable, and I'm here to educate myself about pay-as-you-throw.
And I'm Mike McGuire from Barnstable County Cooperative Extension. I'm Dave's boss. I'm here to evaluate this coffee. So I'm taking comments for that. Nice of them. Don't drink Dave's coffee after 3 p.m.
I'm Tricia Debs, last but not least, of the Dennis Pay-as-you-throw. The two challenges that I'm interested in is how to handle cases of hardship, financial hardship for people, and also with I think we're the only town, I could be mistaken, on the Cape that requires town meeting vote on this. The Board of Selectmen cannot just order it. So I'm wondering if anyone has faced that challenge before.
Cliff Allison, just a concerned citizen from Javits.
Christine Wigan. I'm a personal friend of Ted Seeger's for 40-odd years, and I'm a Chatham resident. I'm very interested in getting educated, and I've been listening to him talk trash for years. And he has dragged his sons through trash and counted trash from here to everywhere. So it's the first time I get to see him talk trash to others.
That's a good point. Ted has had all three sons work on waste composition studies with DSM over the last 20 years. It must be mandatory for their family or something. My kids, I haven't done that.
I also wanted to add that I'm a social worker professionally, and I'm very interested in the impact on people who, you know, may not have the finances to go forward. So I'm interested in that.
Great. Well, I'm so glad you came.
Paulette Failing, Chatham Recycles, and chairman of the recently disbanded, because we finished our task, Solid Waste Advisory Task Force, where 3 out of 5 selectmen voted against page and throw, despite our valiant efforts. And I'm also interested in the argument about the hardship on families, families of small children, when you're trying to attract young families to the Cape. That's really what I think our selectmen were most afraid of. So at least we've begun the discussion in chat.
Oh, great. Well, I hope we can have a good discussion about that this morning. And this is Ted Siegler, and I'm going to move ahead now. What we're going to do is I'm going to talk a little bit about why would you do pay-as-you-throw, where's it done, I'm sorry, smart programs, and a little kind of ammunition for talking to people about it. If you, this room seems like most people are in this room are interested in advancing this, but have had challenges. I know some of you were just want to learn more, and maybe you're on the fence about this, but we're going to start with why would you even do this? Where are they doing this? What are some of the successes? How do you do this? We're going to take a break. We're going to talk about the barriers, which I think this group really wants to discuss. What are some of the reasons why the public, public officials don't want to move this forward? How do you overcome those barriers? And then we'll get into how you set rates if we have time. And we can do rate setting another time too with this group.
And while Natalie is struggling with the board, I can tell you that we have spent a lot of really late night meetings at City Council and Select Board meetings where it comes down to the wire, and there's a lot of opposition, a lot of support. So we fully understand the issues. It often takes 6 to 9 months or a year. In the case of Concord, New Hampshire, it took them 3 times, 5 years before they finally implemented it. So you're not alone. For whatever reason, people pay for sewer and water without objecting. They might not like the rates, but when it comes to garbage, for some reason they don't think that they should pay for that. They think it should be in property taxes. And it's very frustrating, but it's the case all over the place.
So why would DSM from Vermont be down here talking to all of you on the Cape? You know your programs. There's a lot of people in Massachusetts who know your programs. But we've been around since 88, so over 25 years, and we were incorporated to serve state and local government and to work on solid waste management challenges. After RCRA was passed, there was a lot of things to be done with solid waste and to start recycling more, increase recovery in municipalities and cities and at the state level, so we've done a lot of policy analysis too. We've worked with large cities, Boston, New York, Columbus, Hartford, Knoxville. We've worked with, you know, Concord, New Hampshire, medium-sized cities. We've worked with lots of small towns. We're from Vermont. We know what small towns with drop-offs are like. We've worked with populations that have seasonal populations. They might be winter and summer, just winter, both. Vermont has a lot of that. Certainly Rhode Island, Newport, and Middletown, we're working with that just finished a project with the two of them. We've worked mostly on the East Coast, but done national projects too. And we've worked in, DSM has worked in 16, or TED has 16 countries around the globe. I've worked in about 6. Our specialty is garbage and recycling. And how do you increase it? How do you manage it to reduce costs? We've done a lot of work with program budgeting, how to set fees to cover your costs, and how to have a fee that's an incentive to recycle more, but that's set, again, to cover your costs, how to set up an enterprise fund. Any of you have any good communities that have pay-as-you-throw or just started Sandwich, do they have enterprise funds?
No one? They do.
Yep. Okay. So, and we're working, we've been working with Middletown and Newport on smart programs. We're working in Connecticut. We're just starting a project at Old Lyme, who wants to implement a smart program in Old Lyme, Connecticut, which is a coastal community.
You should be able to just tap anywhere and
there we go. It seems like the very edge of the arrow.
You have to be on the right, apparently.
The right of it, yeah.
I've been watching your finger.
Okay. Thank you. You mean back here? No, I'm kidding. Okay. So you heard me already go back and forth, pay-as-you-throw, unit-based pricing, smart. What is it? Okay. For some, pay-as-you-throw, maybe this has been the case in your community, maybe it's kind of a dirty word or a bad word, and rebranding it, which the EPA did, MassDEP's taken off with as smart, save money and reduce trash, seems to have worked in a lot of places. I will say in Connecticut, they call it unit-based pricing, but in Mass here, they're trying to call it smart. That's what we're gonna call it. Essentially, it's all the same thing. It's either a volume or user-based pricing, a variable rate pricing. Some of them call them a green bag program or a green cart. Essentially, doesn't matter what we call it, we're talking about having some sort of unit-based fees for your garbage. Why would you do it? The whole idea is to remove the cost of solid waste and recycling from municipal budgets and property taxes. Have an enterprise fund just like for water or sewer, a separate fund, track your costs, charge the fees, and also have an economic incentive to recycle more, to divert more material to composting, yard waste diversion, reuse, or waste reduction. It's been proven to increase recycling and yard waste diversion and to encourage waste reduction and reuse. And there certainly is data that supports that everywhere. You've heard Dave talk about some of the numbers already.
Natalie, can I ask a quick question?
Sure.
Can we make the slides available to everybody?
Absolutely.
So they can get them to you. So
and,
if you
and we're actually we're recording this, so anyone who wasn't able to make it, this will be available as a presentation to them as well.
So you don't have to.
Yeah, everyone that gave Dave an email address when you registered, we can send this out to you. Okay, I just didn't want to create a lot of waste by handing out a big packet of paper, particularly since we have about 10 people from Dennis, so maybe they Okay, so these are, you know, I said there's a lot of data out there. There's a range. You go from one area. It's different in every town. What are your savings going to be or your reductions in waste disposed? Depends where you're starting from, right? And what are you measuring? What are we counting? But the range and associated cost savings might be from 25% to as much as 50% reported. Certainly there's communities that are greater than 50%. I think Dartmouth was in the 60s, not far from here. Reductions can occur from a whole variety of reasons, and I bet this group could add to this list, but these are the primary ones. There really is more recycling and more yard waste diversion. There is an incentive not to put the waste in that pay-as-you-throw bag or cart or however you charge it and to divert it either to composting or recycling. That's the primary reason why the Mass Recycling Challenge is sponsoring this. They want to see more recycling in the state. They want to know what are some of the tools that haven't been used enough, could be used more in communities. Certainly there's more incentive to donate items because now you have to pay for every single thing that you either bring to the transfer station or get picked up at the curb. Reductions in illegal use of the current program. I've certainly worked with a lot of communities. I won't name them, and they aren't on the Cape, but not far from here, where you're sitting at the transfer station and everybody's sneaking in and saying they're from the town and it's unlimited drop-off and they've got the big pickup truck. Or maybe they are from the town, but pickup trucks filled with, you know, their aunt's furniture and their cousins and their friends, and you know, every Saturday they bring it in. Same goes with the curb, with these curb programs where you can put as much as you want out at the curb. And Boston certainly has experienced this. And people are driving in on their way to work and just dropping stuff off, and, or maybe dropping off those things that aren't accepted in their curbside program. Also, limitations on what can be set up. You know, do you want to contain it and have people pay for everything above that? Backyard composting, certainly see increases in that, and other forms of waste and materials diversion. Here's some examples, some numbers. Decreases in refuse, here's a little range, 25% to 51%. Cohasset, Duxbury, Sandwich, Wrentham, Attleboro, Dartmouth, some communities all not too far from here. Question?
There's one thing you left off that list, maybe you'll address it later. To me, this all starts with people when they're buying things. And I think educating people about not having anything unnecessary and how they basically, I mean, you know, the world seems to view us all as consumers. So how do you consume things or consume less or buy less or be more conscious of what you're purchasing? And I think it's really an important part of this whole discussion. Are you going to address that?
We can talk a little bit more about that, certainly. I mean, there's a lot we can talk about the psychology of human behavior and at what point, you know, a price point triggers a change in behavior or what are, or education, other things. Certainly when we're talking about unit-based pricing, we're talking about having a high enough bag rate or charge that it makes somebody think about throwing something away. Beyond that, there's the environmental benefits of recovering or not buying it in the first place. All of those are, you know, the reason to have a unit-based pricing or a smart program, but also to have a good education program. So we'll talk a little bit about it.
You probably circle back to this, but I like the cost savings line to the right there. I'm wondering if you have metrics that say, what do you think is a range of cost savings per household?
That's a good question. I think it varies by household, certainly. But again, where are they starting from? What are they paying now, as opposed to
yeah,
or nothing?
Like if you have Cohasset.
Oh, you mean divided by the household count?
Divided by the household.
Yeah.
I mean, what's, you know, if each household, if that's representing like $20 a year or $50 a year per household, and the cost of the bags is only 20 or 50, it's an even trade-off. I mean,
right.
I'm just trying to.
You mean the cost of purchasing the bags?
Well, whatever. You haven't got to that yet, but I just.
Yeah.
A rough idea would be if a household generates a ton of waste a year, which is not that far off, and the town saves, say, in your case, with CMAS now, where almost all the Cape towns go, went from $37 a ton to $67 a ton. Every ton of waste that gets diverted saves the town $67, and a household's generating about a ton a year. So that gives you some idea. A typical household may cut the amount that they throw away by between 25% and 50% by going to this. So the savings, the disposal and cost savings on a household basis aren't enough to really generate enough incentive for people to really move forward with pay-as-you-throw. It's not enough on an individual household basis. But when you add the collection costs for garbage, and you add the recycling costs and the composting costs, and you add those to the pay-as-you-throw program, that's when the savings really start to accrue.
Question?
I've done sort of an initial analysis for the town of Barstool. We and our transfer station produce about 9,500 tons a year. If you reduce that by 40%, you multiply it by the tipping fee, which you described, for Barnstable, it could be as much as $250,000 a year. And over the course of a 10-year period, we're talking $2.5 billion, obviously. So there's substantial savings, and I think that's sort of the preferred way to look at it. What are the savings to your ratepayers, not to the individual household, which it may be only $20 to $30 or $40 per year. I just don't think that's the right way to look at it. I think you look at all of your ratepayers and what's the impact. I mean, that would certainly be what I'd argue.
And that's the way typically that pay-as-you-throw programs have been sold, and the municipalities that typically bring DSM in to help them are municipalities that have a budget crisis or a budget issue. They're looking for a way to reduce costs, and all of a sudden, unit-based pricing for garbage seems like a really logical way to do it. You don't have to drive it that way, but I would say most of the municipalities and the select boards and city councilors that eventually go for unit-based pricing over whatever public opposition do it because of the budget savings that they're going to see as a municipal-wide. So you're totally right. That is the primary driver. Yet it's helpful that you get a lot more recycling and composting of yard waste, but it's primarily because they want to save money.
Is it not true to say that there is significant savings potentially if you go to a curbside program as opposed to what people pay privately now? I mean, if you can pay $600 a year for a curbside pickup, but a dump sticker is what, 150? So if you could get something close.
Yeah. Or if a town has a contract, I think we have Falmouth who has contracted curbside collection, is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So a town with a contract, if you look at the cost of that contract and you look at how many households it serves, your cost per household is probably a lot less than if you go to the next town and someone chooses to subscribe for curbside service, because the haulers driving down the street and picking up every fifth house or tenth house or whatever it is. So the system cost is a lot lower when you have that contract.
And that's what drove Middletown, Rhode Island, to pay-as-you-throw originally. Was the transfer station was closing. They had a whole series of private haulers. We did an analysis for them, showed them what the savings would be if they had a contract with a single hauler and pay-as-you-throw, and they saved almost $500,000 by doing that. So it was huge for Middletown, but that was exactly the reason that they did it.
But they do trash pickup as part of their tax.
No, they have they had a transfer station, but they went to pay as you throw with a curbside collection contract.
Do you have any municipalities that use a combination of both?
Transfer stations and curbside? Sure, there's plenty of those that do that.
And if people are not using it, you know, if you don't have a majority of the population using the transfer station, then obviously they're on curbside.
I was going to say the nearby example of that is in Plymouth. Janine works with them. They just started a pay-as-you-throw curbside program. They had three transfer stations. They kept one of the transfer stations open. So residents have the option of doing a curbside pay-as-you-throw program or a transfer station pay-as-you-throw program.
Or both.
Or
they
both.
Can choose both. So they have three options.
Yeah, and there's different fees depending on
exactly.
what they choose.
Yep.
Yeah. So you had a question. Yeah.
This isn't really a question. In Falmouth, we've had curbside as long as I can remember, and I think since World War II. And if everybody puts out, you know, if our total trash is halved at curbside, we still pay
for
that
the contract.
Curbside contract. You know, even if they picked up only one bag of garbage over the whole town.
But maybe the next time you put that contract out to bid, they know it's all about tons per hour, okay? So they know that they picked up these many tons in 2013 and 2014. They halved it, or you know, they cut it by a third or whatever, and they know that this community is this many tons, it's this many households, and maybe you get a more you know, aggressive bid.
And that's what happened both in Concord, New Hampshire, which had curbside collection before they went to pay-as-you-throw and had a transfer station, and in Middletown, Rhode Island, when they went out to rebid their curbside collection contract, both curbside collection contracts went down in price 5 years later because the haulers were picking up less trash. And as Natalie said, almost all of the private waste haulers run their numbers based on tons per hour picked up, or pounds per household picked up.
And how it's picked up.
Right.
I mean, are there limitations on how it can be set out? Is it containerized? Is it in a car? Do you have bulky waste every day? Or is it just once a month? Or is it call-in? And we work with a lot of different communities working just on that. How do you make the pickup itself more efficient for the hauler? Because that's going to come down to reducing your collection costs. And collection costs are typically 70% of your total solid waste system costs. So you want it. You're absolutely right. You want to figure out a way to reduce those too. So here are some communities in Mass. We could go on with lots of examples. We've talked about this. More reuse. Also, individual behavior change. And I've forgotten your name. Has brought this up. Richard has brought up. You know, are you going to purchase less or in bulk? Purchase products with less packaging. Purchase products to be reused or recycled and composted. Are you going to look for more reuse options and donate things instead of throwing them in the dumpster? Again, the economic signal that you're going to have to pay for everything you throw out starts to get at behavior change and at reuse. How much trash did we throw out in Massachusetts? This chart compares all the communities in Mass. The darker or orange colors are the higher pounds per household. The green, the white are the lower pounds per household. Hatched is no data. So you can see it's a wide variety. Obviously, probably the household counts aren't perfect in this chart, so this is not a perfect chart, but it gives you an idea of maybe who's generating more per household and who's generating less.
Before you move forward, the hatched is actually the smart pay-as-you-throw communities.
Oh, sorry.
Yep. The thing I love most about that map is, just at a glance, it's very clear that those municipalities with the hatch marks are in the greens and the yellows, which is the lower trash per household per year.
Thank you very much for pointing that out.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
That's Dave's work.
Yeah, Dave. Thank you, Dave. Question in the back?
Yes, just a quick question about the map and the data that you use. One of our challenges in Barnstable is determining precisely how much trash is disposed and how much is recycled, because about 30% of our community uses curbside pickup. And the data is basically non-existent. We've got anecdotal data from our haulers when we were studying this, that about 10% of their customers recycle. The other challenge at our transfer station is, because the town of Barnstable allows non-residents to dispose of their recyclables at no cost, when you look at the total trash disposed of and the recycling disposed of for Barnstable's transfer station, the number is skewed. So it appears as though we have a higher recycling rate because we're taking all these additional recyclables. So my question is, how did you maybe Dave can mention this, because he knows the challenge as well, that the data, and what data did you use?
Yeah, so the data for this is all from MassDEP's annual survey. So this is data that's, this is a trash tonnage from the town programs only. So it's only counting the, in Barnstable's case, the transfer station. So it's basically total tons of trash divided by number of households using the transfer station, so number of permits sold. So in some cases, you know, in Barnstable's case, it is a little challenging because it's only a small portion of the total households. But yeah, so basically it's just looking at, on the, in the Cape, the transfer station users.
You need to be careful with all of these, all the data points that are based on voluntary filling out data forms and sending it in. But we can say, because we collect a lot of data, we sort a lot of garbage, we just finished sorting garbage in Boston, looking at recovery rates, that municipalities that have pay-as-you-throw do really reduce the amount of trash that they throw away, whether it's curbside or drop-off. But you're totally right, these statewide maps are useful, but they have all of the problems associated with data from different ways of reporting.
But all of you know your communities best, and getting the correct numbers together in order to make your argument for why unit-based pricing is a good idea in your community is very important. And that's a lot of what DSM does when we work with communities, so that they have the real figures at hand to talk about and to make estimates about what the reductions might be from the real figures representative of their community only.
I have a question, John Morris, I have a question about the cost of disposing recycled material. For quite a few years, Wellfleet had an arrangement with a vendor where they picked up our glass and plastic and paper for free. They didn't give us any money, we didn't pay them, we didn't pay a trucking charge. And the DPW director told us it was a pretty good deal. Very recently, the arrangement changed so that they're charging us $40 a ton to truck it to their place. And we're still not getting any money, and they're not charging us for it. So my question to the general audience and yourself is, I'd like to understand how that works with your towns. I'm hoping you get a better deal than $40 a ton. Because that cost of disposing of the recycling is quite significant.
And you have everything separated? That's Wellfleet, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So it's collected in one location, and the $40 is what they charge?
We have a drop-off transfer station. Customers put the bottles in one area, paper and cardboard in another, and plastic and cans in a third.
So the charges from that point forward.
Correct.
So how about we do this? It's John, right?
Yes.
So at the break, if anyone who knows the numbers to recycle their material, could you meet with John?
Sure.
Okay, and anyone else that has those numbers at hand? And maybe we can put this question out to the towns as a group also.
Yeah, we can compile that.
Yeah. Because it does fluctuate, and it fluctuates with the market, and
there is a
better deal.
It's a complicated answer, but we're happy to sit down and talk with you afterwards as well, and tell you what some of the issues are. We can understand why it's happening, but it would take quite a while to do it. So.
By material basis. So just a little bit more quickly, these are why you might do it. It's happening across the U.S. This is old data. This is 2005 to 2006. The number's higher than that, but there's 7,500 municipalities across the U.S. that have programs already. There's a lot in Massachusetts already. Here's the map. Curbside is these blue-green, and drop-off, it's hard to see the difference, is it greener, and then both curbside and drop-off, there's a number of those too, and I bet Dave would know the specific communities. And we also can send that list out because MassDEP keeps really good data. And then we look at the Cape. We talked about there's three programs, two very new ones, one in Sandwich that's been around a little bit, and then up at Plymouth, and then Duxbury, and so on. So there are smart programs, but on the Cape, as you know, but not a lot.
I'm Paul Pilcher from Wellfleet. Maybe you're going to get to this later, but one of the big issues that seems to be percolating in our town is we have two-thirds
or more of our housing is seasonal housing for the summer. And so a lot of folks are saying, you know, this is not going to work during the summer when you have people coming in who are just there for a week, or people are coming in for a couple of weeks, or people who are just there for the summer. They're not going to want to
participate. And you use bags in Wellfleet?
Yes.
Okay, so I would say, as a complete outsider, knowing I've been to Wellfleet not in a while, and I don't know the exact fluctuation. I can imagine it's 10 to 1 or something like that. Okay.
So a population of about 3,000 to 20,000 in the summer.
Okay, so you have a bag program. You have your households having to use those bags. And what percentage of the households use the transfer station or drop off? Rough.
I mean, most people use the transfer station. One of the key objections is coming from the commercial haulers. We're saying if they were to pick it up, even if this trash was in the bags, their trucks will, when they're compacting it, will shred the bags and you'll never be able to tell.
So are those small haulers coming to your transfer station?
They say they're not going to.
Yeah. Well, a couple of things, and we can talk more about this on the break and after when we talk about barriers, but there are plenty of communities that have seasonal populations that have pay-as-you-throw at drop-offs and transfer stations. Part of the deal, whether it's a house that's rented out to someone different every week or whether it's a house that's owned by a family and they just come in the summer or come for a week here and there, that house just buys the pay-as-you-throw bags and leaves it in the house just like a year-round household. Then they also may have a sticker to use the transfer station, which serves as their reminder that this program's in effect, so when they get the sticker, they get the information about the program. In a rental situation, it's part of the rental agreement. You rent it for a week, there's pay-as-you-throw bags in the bag. Either the bags are left out, you know, for the whoever picks it up. Maybe that's a property manager at the end of the week, or maybe that household actually drives to the drop-off. It's different every situation. I know a small town that have that. Yeah, sorry.
I'm not disagreeing with you. And
that doesn't mean it's easy.
Those are arguments that we've made, but the argument that's being made is when you look at Duxbury and you look at Sandwich and you look at the other towns in the Cape, none of them has quite this kind of proportion
10 to 1,
of seasonal to resident.
But it's just an argument that somehow we're different and it couldn't possibly work here, which is basically what we hear every place that we go. And yes, there are issues associated with that, but that is not an insurmountable problem. And there are plenty of other communities that have high seasonal fluctuations that do have pay-as-you-throw programs. And in the case of haulers, yes, they don't like pay-as-you-throw, especially the small subscription haulers. But it's not that hard to know whether the waste is in a pay-as-you-throw bag, if that's what you're using, or bags. And many haulers who bid out total municipalities have to only pick up waste in pay-as-you-throw bags, and they have no problem bidding out the contract and completing the contract. So I think it's more of a way for small haulers to protest against it rather than a real implementation barrier, quite frankly.
Can you go back to the map for one second?
Okay.
I'm just going to offer this to everybody. The map actually is very instructive. We're in Barnstable County right now, but below us is another county called Dukes County. And 100% of the communities in Dukes County are using some form of this program, and they've been doing it for a while now because their cost to haul their trash involves a boat. And so they adopted this program. And so if you want to, I mean, we have really a model nearby. We want to go see how small haulers and communities and seasonal people deal with that and have been dealing with it for a number of years effectively. It's right next door.
Right. Talk about seasonal functionality. I worked on Nantucket for a while, and they are zero. They're 100% recycling. You cannot throw a bag. They have clear bags.
Right.
You cannot throw anything that has anything recyclable in it.
Right. I'm just saying, you know, if this was a disease vector graph, we'd be worried about what's coming from those islands right now. Yeah.
Keep that barrier. What I'm saying is there is a way to deal with it. I mean, each town has to deal with it in their own certain way. If you want to implement something like that, whether it be a pay-as-you-throw or 100% recycling, there's going to be challenges to every one, each one that you do?
And implementation takes time. And so there's always a period of time, which is the implementation period. You're never going to have 100% compliance right away. It's going to take time. But the idea that you're serious about having the program be successful, that it's possible, and that it's working together to get there is important. And that means once in a while, you have to go out and enforce. And certainly in Middletown, Rhode Island, they didn't have perfect compliance right away. They had bags and carts, first bag and cart program in the country. We went looking for one. We couldn't find any examples. Middletown decided to go ahead with it anyway, and we helped them implement it, and they've been very happy with it. But that doesn't mean it wasn't, you know, easy right away.
I just wanted to add that Plymouth's program is bags and carts as well. Started in January.
In January. I
know Nantucket is used often as an example of incredible recycling rate, but it's important to know that their traditional recycling rate is 42%. They achieve that 90% with their
Digester.
I mean, even though it is very commendable. I wanted to ask, do you have an opinion about bags for haulers? Yeah. Whether you think that's necessary in a patient through a program? Because they're kind of already paying, well, they are definitely already paying by weight.
But the signal's not going to come back to the household.
That's true.
Okay, unless the household, you want the behavior change at the household level, and the hauler can't institute that behavior change. So the bag is what does that. Because every time you use that bag, think I bought it, it was $2 at the store, I've only got two left, I'm going to, you know.
But is
that? I think the hauler can, through your education and free recycling containers and maybe charge per container. Using the bags for the hauler seems like an
You don't have to use bags. We're going to actually get to that in a minute. We're going to talk about the different ways to do it.
Yeah, and all I'm saying, it depends on, is the hauler part of your program or not? Is the hauler, you know, what is it that the municipality is instituting? What kind of an ordinance they have? Do they use your transfer station? Are they on their own? And from working from there, what are you going to use it as an instrument? So just moving ahead quickly and giving Ted the podium.
As if I haven't been taking it already.
Right. We've talked about this, 15% of the population now, this is the year-round population, of course, has smart-based pricing. Mm-hmm. We've talked about some of the reasons why that there isn't more. One of the things we haven't really talked about, but we will more after the break, is the recycling infrastructure is really not as well developed for the curbside haulers. And you do have we don't know exactly what the correct number is, but you have some percentage of the population, probably more than 50%, but I could be wrong about that, has curbside pickup of refuse. And probably the majority of that is picked up by private haulers. And they probably don't have a place to tip their recyclables easily, so that keeps them from having recycling service the same day as the refuse service. So that the household, if you had pay-as-you-throw at the hauler level, the household needs a just as easy place to put the recycling. If you ask the household to put their trash out on the curb and then drive their recycling to a transfer station when it's open on Saturday or Wednesday or whatever the hours are, but really they have to get in their car, you're asking for them to do one more thing. You've got to make it just as easy. And we were talking about Boston a moment before in the study that we just did. Well, Ted just published an article in Research Recycling. Did any of you read that periodical? Anyway, we can send it to you. It's all about parallel recycling, having refuse and recycling exactly the same. And when you have that, you have incredibly high recycling rates. And when you don't have that, which is the case in a lot of households in the Cape, you're going to struggle with having a high recycling rate. So my last slide, and then I'll hand it over to Ted. He gets 5 minutes. Why is it important to target the Cape communities, other than some of the things we've already talked about? Well, you're still throwing. This is a chart. This is a waste composition study that's done every couple of years. Is that right? Is it every 3 years?
I think every 3 years.
Yeah. And this is CMAS's data. So they go out and study the data, and they do a little report. And this is available to all of you. More than half of the material going to CMAS now could be recycled or composted. This is actually 2011 data, but not too far off. And so why is that the case? I mean, why isn't more of this material recycled? It might be because there isn't more incentive or more opportunity to recycle on the Cape. and this is food waste down here, 14%. Recyclable paper, this is always amazes me how much paper is still getting thrown away. And you guys aren't alone. We're always amazed how much cardboard still gets thrown away in different states. Containers, recyclable containers, even scrap metal, grocery bags, and then yard waste. Textiles, 6%. That's amazing.
What is C and D?
Construction and demolition waste.
CD.
So that's just the little projects at the household level, not the big construction projects, because that waste is separate. But there's still a fair amount of C&D construction waste that gets mixed in with household trash. And certainly wood waste, clean wood, that could be recovered. So now we're going to talk about different program types. We're going to try and emphasize drop-offs, because we've got a lot of drop-off communities here, but we'll touch on curbside too.
And now I have to use that smart board, Natalie.
I'll do it for you. I'll do it for you. Just touch the blue nose of it.
So program types, as Natalie said, this is just a list of all of the different program types that you might be able to implement if you are a drop-off community or a curbside program. So there are other ways to do it besides just pay-as-you-throw bags. We show that, and most of Massachusetts does use pay-as-you-throw bags. But punch carts are much more popular in, say, Maine and Vermont than they are down in Massachusetts. And the town that I go to, which we're going to use as one of the examples, uses punch carts, and they work just as well. Scales for pickup trucks and larger vehicles. Obviously, if you have a scale at your transfer station, and you're paying by weight, that's the fairest way to do it. And bulky waste, there's all sorts of ways to charge for bulky waste, and we'll talk about that. At the curb, it can be in carts, so that you don't have bags at all, and you can base your whole pay-as-you-throw program based on the size of the cart.
What do they have in Falmouth? They don't have carts, do they?
No. Massachusetts has a new grant program, so if you are a curbside town, they will pay, I think it's $15 per household, if you're willing to provide households with 35-gallon carts as the base size of the cart, as opposed to 64 gallons, which typically have been used in the past. And they view that as essentially a de facto way of driving down the amount of waste that people put in their carts. So that's another way to do it. So here are some of the transfer station options. Bags typically sold at retailers, not at the transfer station. We have never advocated that cash change hands at the transfer stations. We've done a lot of work for the state of Maine trying to improve the efficiency of operations of transfer stations, and we've worked really hard to get rid of the idea of people paying cash at the transfer station. Essentially, the great thing about bag programs, and one of the reasons that so many municipalities have bag programs, is that they really don't have to deal with the bags. The bag suppliers will do the entire distribution, ordering, billing of all the retail outlets, and then send the remaining money back to the municipality, less the cost of the bags and their fee. And so that is the standard way all around the United States that bag programs are implemented. And I should say that one of the earliest bag programs in the whole United States is actually Worcester, Mass, which just celebrated its 20th year of pay-as-you-throw bag program. And that's a municipality with a very large student population, very large transient population. I didn't realize it's the second largest college community in the state and one of the largest in the United States. And it also has a very large low-income population. They have been successful for a very long time with pay-as-you-throw bags.
And what they do is they use email that goes out through Residential Life to all the students at the beginning of the year, so they're off campus, they're in housing, they're a transient seasonal population, but they all know that pay-as-you-throw is bags are what they use in Worcester.
And similarly with punch cards, my town uses a little tiny punch card that you can buy at the local convenience store. And they work just as well. The transfer station attendant, in this case, looks to see how many 32-gallon capacity waste cans you brought in or bags that you brought in, and charges you based on the number of punches. And that's a very efficient way to do it without having to use plastic bags for all of your waste. Bulky waste You can do it by unit or volume. We have some communities that have, you know, a sheet that's got 50 different items and a different price for every item. And other municipalities that just have two prices, maybe $15 for up to a certain size and $30 or $20 for harder to handle materials. So there are a lot of different examples around the United States in terms of ways to charge for bulky waste.
Excuse me, sir, perhaps I misunderstood you, but when you said that using a punch card, I thought you said the attendant at the transfer station decides how much to charge you?
They decide how many punches to punch on the punch card.
Oh, so you need somebody to punch, but it's no exchange?
No cash exchange.
Oh,
so you buy your punch card at the local convenience store. The,
right.
The convenience store essentially buys the cards from the town of Wethersfield, Vermont in this case. The town gives them I think it's 5 or 10% discount on the card, so they make a little tiny bit of money. But as Cliff knows, because he's gone to the Wethersfield transfer station with me more than once, that convenience store is absolutely packed with people every Saturday morning and Sunday morning, getting coffee, buying their punch card, buying something else at the convenience store. The convenience store loves the fact that they're near the transfer station and that they're selling the punch cards. And then when you get there, you essentially hand the attendant your punch card.
Couldn't that make a problem in queuing up?
How's the queuing line there?
It's very quick. The transfer, the guy actually sits in this little booth, and as you can only put two people. It's a drive up to a compactor,
okay.
So only a couple cars can unload at one time anyway, and he's just counting as you're unloading, and then you just hand him the punch card, he just punches it with his little puncher, and you are on your way. So
we have it at mine. I go to a different transfer station in the town next door, and same thing, and you're right, there's a line coming through, but it's amazing what an incentive it is if for you to just have everything in recycling separate, and then just that one can or two cans or whatever you have, and they just look in the back and point, punch, punch.
Yeah.
Give it back to you, obviously.
Yeah. You know, you're touching on, I think, a bigger question of opposition. It is simply, people like their lives simple lives. They want to do the right thing with no more effort than they have to put into it. And so what I hear in my town is, well, it's a great idea, but you know, how much is this going to inconvenience me between all the things I do in my life and what I have to do? And that's a basis of the general question, I think, that's maybe a little simplified, but I think that's what we're hearing. To that end, the simplest process we can find, and we have, by the way, we drop off at a transfer station. We don't have curbside pickup at Dennis. Mm-hmm. The simplest we can make this happen, better our chances of successfully selling it to the town, quite frankly. And that's, you know, as I'm listening with that ear as we're talking about ways to get this stuff.
And I, for me, the idea that you can just simply go to any convenience store in town and buy a punch card when you want it, and I basically just clip it to the visor on my pickup truck, and it's always there. You know, if I run out, I can drive to the convenience store. I need gas anyway, or coffee anyway, and I pick up another punch card. It's really not very inconvenient to do that. It's no less convenient than going to the supermarket and buying your pay-as-you-throw bags, because essentially that's the way pay-as-you-throw bags are sold. As well, is that you buy them at a supermarket. And everyone has to shop for food, everyone gets gas, everyone does all those things anyway. The main point here is wherever it would be convenient for you to shop, that's where you buy your punch card or your bags.
Question back?
Yeah, I can submit. I had read that the reason that communities had chosen bags as opposed to punch cards or stickers is that the effective rate of trash reduction was enhanced with bags as opposed to stickers or punch cards. I'd be curious to know whether that is accurate. And I guess with respect to the bags, almost everybody goes to the grocery store to buy their trash bags. So if all they have to do is buy a different kind of trash bag, that's not as hard of an argument to have to make, I don't think. But I am curious about the effectiveness of stickers and punch cards versus bags.
I think that it's probably the case that bags are slightly more effective for this reason. You spec the bags based on a weight that you want them to hold, and typically pay-as-you-throw bags are spec so that they will rip if you put too much garbage in them on purpose. So if you think that you want to have a kind of a maximum weight of 30 pounds in a bag, then you, then pay-as-you-throw bags are going to be specced so that if you stuff 40 or 50 pounds into it, it's going to rip. That's that's more of an incentive to reduce the amount that goes into each pay-as-you-throw bag as opposed to driving into the transfer station. And I've got all of my trash, I've jumped up and down on my 32-gallon trash can, and then I dump it all in there. So there probably is somewhat more of an incentive for with pay-as-you-throw bags. One of the problems that DSM has with pay-as-you-throw bags, and this is really just a personal opinion, is that we do a lot of work with plastic, and the volume of plastic going into landfills has just escalated amazingly. And plastic bags in general are a very large portion of what's going into landfills these days. It's not as much of an issue here because you're burning it all at sea mass and it's a carbon source, so it's not as much of an issue. So I probably am a little biased against plastic bags because I sort a lot of them at landfills. But
and,
I think
and because
you're right.
Our waste goes up north to a landfill versus your waste goes to a waste energy facility.
But I think you're right. You probably get better reduction with pay-as-you-throw bags than with punch cards.
Okay, and then Janice, you have a question here.
This punch card is really intriguing. I frankly never heard of this. Do you have to prove residency when you purchase it?
In the case of Weathersfield, where I go, I live in the adjoining town of West Windsor, and Weathersfield allows West Windsor, Reading, and Weathersfield to use the transfer station. You have to buy a sticker that goes on your windshield, which you pay $50 for. Everyone does, whether you're Weathersfield or West Windsor. And then you can buy the punch card. You can't use the transfer station, which has free recycling, free composting, unless you have the sticker on your vehicle. So the restriction is the sticker on the vehicle. Anyone can go into the store and buy the punch card.
How much is your punch card?
Each punch is $2, and so you can buy a punch card with 5, which is a $10 card, or you can buy one with 10, which is a $20 card.
And I guess any size container. Okay.
You can, and so I don't use bags at all. I just use 32-gallon, you know, standard plastic garbage cans, and each one of those is one punch. So the attendant is essentially sitting there, I'm dumping my garbage cans, he's keeping a mental note of how many garbage cans I just dumped, and then he's punching the punch card before I leave.
Thank you.
And just to get on to the seasonal population, Franconia, New Hampshire, where I spent a lot of time, it was a house we go to, and they have to have a sticker per vehicle, but instead the sticker's on a piece of cardboard, and so whoever's staying at the house and the pay-as-you-throw bags are in the drawer next to the garbage can, it's just this tiny house, and one's always left lining the garbage can in the kitchen. And you grab the cardboard, you put it on the dash of your car, and you grab the bag, and you go down to the transfer station. And so that's there's constantly different people coming in that house, and they all can go use the drop-off, and they're very seasonal. They come for the weekend, they come for a week, but they're all operating under the pay-as-you-throw system.
What's been your experience with handling of this styrofoam problem? Pay-as-you-throw versus styrofoam.
We are actually doing this huge project for the International marine plastic workforce, and so for us, expanded polystyrene is a significant problem from a marine environment point of view. The good thing is that there is a new expanded foam product which is made out of polypropylene, which is going to be able to replace most of the expanded polystyrene cups and serviceware, and is completely recyclable and does not shatter. So we think that we're going to see, especially for food service expanded polystyrene, it going away as it's replaced by expanded foam polypropylene, which would be great. As far as recycling it, pretty much impossible. You can't manage it through a regular recycling program. There are some large wholesalers and retail chains that have what's called a densifier, where you essentially cram all of the polystyrene into it, and it compresses it and melts it into a block. But other than that, it's quite difficult to recycle.
But what about the cost factor when you're getting your 32-gallon bag?
It's if you have a lot of stuff, expanded polystyrene, you're going to pay for it.
But this comes back to your point about incentive for waste reduction or for purchasing a different type of packaging. Right there, you know, polystyrene is very voluminous, so it's going to take up a lot of space in your bag. So and it's not easily recyclable.
We actually just did a pilot styrofoam collection Brewster. So we collected styrofoam in a 40-yard dumpster for 3 weeks after Christmas. We wanted to see if people would be interested in it. People loved it. They filled up the entire container. The problem is when we weighed it out, it was only 280 pounds. So you know, we had to pay $400 to have the vendor come down. So if you do the math, that's $2,500 per ton. I've been looking into options for densifiers. They range in cost from $20,000 up to $100,000. And you could do that, and you could compact it into blocks and sell it. But the vendors that I've found that can come and get it need a minimum of a whole trailer full. So that's basically 35,000 pounds before they'll come pick it up to pay for it. So I mean, that's multiple years of collection for multiple towns. So it's just really not feasible to do. I know some towns occasionally allow people to throw the big blocks into the hopper outside of the bags. I think Sandwich does that. Lovely allows that. And I think that makes sense after Christmas. Give people a break. Don't make people pay $2 for
all right, Richard has comments.
I'm sure some of us have gotten those little things that look, I don't know, they look like worms that are made of corn or rice.
Peanut,
that are, you can just wash them down, they're compostable. Oh. Why can't manufacturers start making packaging for large items out of that stuff instead of out of styrofoam? I mean, it just seems ridiculous. I mean, polypropylene might be better, but it's still a plastic. It's still going to add carbon to the atmosphere and use petroleum to be created. Why isn't there more incentive to use vegetable materials for packaging? I just don't understand.
There are a number of manufacturers who, there are a lot of consumers who don't like expanded polystyrene packaging. And so there are a lot of other options. It just happens to be a phenomenally cheap, very good material for protecting something. But there are many people who object to it for the same reasons that you do, there are a lot of manufacturers who are looking at options that don't involve an expanded polystyrene. We're going to just quickly go through a few more slides and then take a quick break, because I know that there's a lot of implementation barrier issues that I know everyone here wants to talk about, and we have heard them all, or probably most of them, and we're happy to talk about them. So. As I said, I think we've pretty much talked about bags. One point to be made is that you can order bags of different sizes. And one of the issues and one of the ways to deal with low income, especially smaller households, is to sell a very small pay-as-you-throw bag at a reasonable price. One of the things that Worcester has done, because there was a lot of concern about low income households to start with, was to keep their bag prices relatively low. Their small bag is 75 cents per bag, and their large bag is $1.50. Started out at 50 and a dollar. Those are relatively low prices. The incentive isn't as great for reducing trash, but because their bag prices are low, the impact on low-income households in Worcester has been relatively minor. So one of the issues associated with that is pick a couple different bag sizes. The other thing is you can choose the sleeve size, the number of bags that you sell at the retail location. So if it's a low-income household that has relatively low disposable income on a weekly or monthly basis, they can buy a smaller number of bags rather than because if you think about it, you go in and you buy 20 or 30 garbage bags, they're not very expensive. But if you buy 20 pay-as-you-throw bags and they're each $2 per bag, that's $40 that you're shelling out at the grocery store. So you can reduce that impact by selling a sleeve that only has, say, five bags in it. So it's $10 instead of $40. So those are some of the ways to reduce the impact on low-income households. And we're going to talk later about how much a household really generates, even a large family household, and put some real numbers to what the costs are. But that is one of the ways to reduce costs. These are just some of the pros and cons. Obviously, we probably talked about most of them already. Pay-as-you-throw bags are really a substitute for a garbage bag. They're easily identifiable by the transfer station attendant. There are no judgment calls. One of the problems with punch cards is that there is a judgment call. The transfer station attendant has to judge that's really 32 gallons as opposed to 50 gallons.
Or there's one person at the transfer station that everyone hates, right? That's the person that's saying, you know, two punches, not one.
Right. The bag thickness, as we talked about, is a size control. It essentially controls how much you can put in the bag. You can obtain that at most retail locations. There are a few store chains that will not sell pay-as-you-throw bags, Market Basket being one of them. I don't know if you have Market Basket down here. But they've been a big holdout. But most retail chains, or most supermarket chains, do sell them. And distribution and payment logistics are handled by a third party, so they really are not an issue for the municipality. Some of the cons we've already talked about as well, more plastic waste. If you're storing bags outside, obviously you have animal problems. Retailers may have to keep pay-as-you-throw bags behind the counter because they are quite valuable compared to most things that you're buying at a grocery store. And one of the issues on the Cape can be that if a retailer, if it's a supermarket and it serves multiple towns and you have multiple pay-as-you-throw programs, then you have to stock multiple bags depending on the town that you're coming from. So that is an issue associated with bags.
And the summer population has to be sure they buy bags to the right transfer station, right?
Right.
And we just simply put this up here because everyone says, you know, we're so much different. Well, Stowe, Vermont has a very large seasonal populations, winter and summer. They have had a transfer station with pay-as-you-throw pricing for a very long time, and people have adapted to it, just as Natalie said for Franconia, New Hampshire. There are a lot of seasonal population municipalities throughout the country that have pay-as-you-throw
pricing. And one of the things they did at Stowe is they used to be a source separated where they had lots of different containers for different types of recyclables, paper, bottles and cans, glass, aluminum. They ended up going to single stream recycling and putting a compactor in. And what that did for them is at the end of the day, it saved them money, even though you would think intuitively why they had, you know, maybe they had to pay or they had to pay a pull charge to bring it out to the Chittenden Wharf, which is 40 miles away. But at the end of the day, they're getting almost 8 tons in this compactor of single stream material, and easy, simple. People loved it because they could mix everything together, and that solved a lot of problems for them.
I'm not sure.
Might be a good stopping point.
Yeah.
Because we've got lots of examples, but we've talked about punch cards.
Yeah, why don't we stop and take a quick break, and then we'll come back and we'll get into all of the barriers, any questions that people have about barriers.
Sure.
We're going to skip over some slides. We have more program stuff, and we can come back to that. Honestly, Natalie and I can stay all day and talk, so that's not a problem. But we know that some of you want to leave at noon time, so we're going to go right to the barriers. So that we can talk about what the barriers are. And here's some of the barriers I'm sure you've heard. One of them is that there are multiple haulers in your municipality and they don't like pay-as-you-throw or smart pricing. And so we're going to talk a little bit about, and I'm just going to do the list first, and then we'll go through each one. And obviously the third one down, implementation of smart, is viewed as just another tax, and we hear that everywhere that we go, and we'll talk to you about what the real issues as we see them are. The negative impact on low-income households, that's certainly an issue that Christine and has talked with me about in the past. I know what Christine does for a living. She deals with a lot of that, those issues. So we'll talk about what some of the issues are for that.
Here's one that hasn't come up, illegal dumping.
Yes. You're making it worse, Natalie.
That's all right.
Illegal dumping is often raised as a huge issue as a barrier. We'll talk about what the real data are on that and the political risk to office holders. There's plenty of those in this room. And there really is a risk to office holders. It takes some courage, but it also takes a lot of education, and we'll talk about that. So let's move on. Subscription collection, I suspect that you've had haulers who have come into municipalities and essentially said it won't work because we're small haulers and we don't like pay-as-you-throw. There are lots of places in this country that have multiple subscription haulers, and the municipality or the county or the region license the subscription haulers and require all of them to implement pay-as-you-throw pricing. And they can do that through a requirement that the haulers offer a minimum size cart that is 35 gallons as opposed to 64 gallons, that they embed the cost of recycling in the charge that they make, which means that you can't, they don't charge extra for recycling. It is part of the cost of refuse collection, so that if you subscribe, your hauler is offering you curbside collection and recycling, and it's embedded in the cost of trash collection, and they're giving you a separate cart or a separate container for it. We do all of the recycling work for the state of Delaware. We've been doing it now for 10 years. We do an annual recycling rate for the state of Delaware. That's required by the legislature. And when we started working in Delaware, they were all subscription haulers, and there was almost no recycling. 5 years ago, 4 or 5 years ago, they adopted as a state a universal recycling law, which required all of the haulers to offer recycling and embed the cost in their refuse collection and to provide a second cart for recycling. They now have one of the highest recycling rates in the country. So this is something that can be done with multiple subscription haulers, and it's done statewide in Delaware. It's done in Chittenden County, which is in Vermont, which is Burlington, and all of the municipalities around there. They have very high recycling rates. They have multiple subscription haulers, but all of them are required to offer pay-as-you-throw pricing. So I realize that most of the people here are interested in pay-as-you-throw for transfer station-based systems, but I also know that a lot of haulers down here oppose the idea of pay-as-you-throw pricing.
In the town of Dennis, our haulers are not required to recycle because the Board of Health has to adopt it. Then they're required. Board of Health won't adopt because they see it as anti-business. We hope to change that with an upcoming meeting. But just to be clear, it needs adoption by the Board of Health from the town of Dennis to go ahead for that to happen, and I presume other towns.
And one of the things that we did about 5 years ago, we did a study for the Northeast Recycling Coalition, where we looked at the number of jobs created by increasing the amount of material that was diverted. And we did it for, was it five states, Natalie?
Yes.
Of which Massachusetts was one of them. And we're really talking millions and millions of dollars worth of value associated with recycling, and thousands of jobs associated with recycling, both on the collection side, the processing side, and on the manufacturing side. So when people say it's bad for business, I think that that's really not a very good argument, because it really is good for business in our country.
And there's more jobs through recycling than disposal.
I just wanted to add my personal observation. I think a lot of the haulers in the pit actually like pay as you throw. I've seen them advertise trying to pull people away from the town programs, using pay as you throw as sort of a fear of having to buy the bags. And especially, I think, in Sandwich and Brewster. In Wellfleet, it's a little bit different because Wellfleet's program has the requirement that the haulers also have to use the bags. So maybe in Wellfleet's case, it's a little bit of a different feeling. But
I just want to clarify that the private haulers collecting Wellfleet have to use the bags if they bring it to the transfer station.
Yes.
If they tip it someplace else, then
And one of the things, just, and I'll get to your question, one of the important issues on the Cape has been, and it is a real barrier, is that small haulers don't have a place to tip single stream recycling, which is what they really need in order for them to implement really aggressive recycling programs for small haulers. And that is going to, that is changing. I know that, and Dave knows more about it than I do.
Yeah, so two things that are changing on the Cape. One is the Yarmouth Regional Transfer Station just reached an agreement with Covanta, so CMS. They're going to be operating that transfer station. And they're working to try to get single stream tipping for haulers in Yarmouth. So that'll be a local option for them to tip there, and then it'll be hauled by rail or by trailer off Cape. Eastham also was just awarded a grant from DEP to look into the feasibility of upgrading the transfer station to allow them to accept single stream recyclables from haulers. So that'll be great if that goes through. If the haulers are interested, that'll be a good option for the Outer Cape. So in the summer, when there's traffic all down Route 6, they can still pick up single stream from their routes, and they don't have to go far. They can just tip it in Eastham. So we're hoping that works out.
And so that when that barrier gets removed, when those two transfer stations have single stream, the ability of haulers to tip single stream recycling, that removes one of the largest objections that most haulers would have. It becomes easier to say all haulers have to offer it.
Some private haulers on the Outer Cape do pick up single stream recycling. Where do they tip it now? I didn't know that was a big problem.
That's a good question. I mean, you.
They may go off Cape to Avon.
That's quite a drive, but.
I think there are some companies. I don't know what each company does, but they're consolidating in a larger trailer at their yard and then hauling it, hauling it off Cape.
Right.
I think it varies from case to case. Some of the really, really small haulers probably are just sorting it and bringing it to the transfer station. But I think it kind of varies case by case. In Chatham, they do allow the haulers to tip at Chatham, but only if you're a Chatham only hauler.
Right? That's right. Okay. It has to be Chatham refuse. Yes. And Chatham does have single stream for the haulers, as Dave just said. And so far, it's break even. It's free. We're not paying for it. We're not getting money for it.
Which is typical.
But it's wonderful. Now, if they just use it enough.
Richard, I know you.
Yeah, I've heard it said, I'm not saying I agree with this, but I've heard it said even by a member of our recycling committee that recycling doesn't, it doesn't go anywhere or it gets shipped to China or it's, in other words, people who have doubts about the fact that stuff actually gets recycled. And I also know that the market for certain recyclables is pretty spongy. So what do you offer as counters to those arguments?
Only that all the largest waste haulers in the United States have invested hundreds of millions of dollars in recycling processing capacity, and all you have to do is go up to one of the single stream MRFs in Massachusetts, and there are now five or six of them. They are all very large, and believe me, they sort every material and they sell every material.
Any of you been to Avon? The waste management MRF, I mean, it's pretty impressive.
Yeah,
I
mean, in Massachusetts or Connecticut?
In Massachusetts.
Massachusetts.
So there is massive amounts of recycling being collected every day, being sorted every day, processed every day, and sold every day. There's way too much value in fiber and in plastic and aluminum to be throwing it away. And yes, the markets do go up and down. There's no question about that. And yes, there is a cost associated with recycling. I think it's a mistake. It always has been a mistake for us to present recycling as free. It's not free. We have to. We generated the material. We have to manage it. But it's less expensive to collect it as recyclables, process it, and sell those materials than it is to collect it as those recyclables as garbage and burn them or bury them.
For most, not all recyclables.
Right.
Depending on where you are, which is why maybe you have a problem in some very small drop-offs with certain materials.
Right. And one of the benefits of single stream recycling is that you then can start, you're right, you don't make money off of the transfer of it because it has to be processed, but you can significantly expand the number of materials that you take, especially with plastics. So instead of only taking PET bottles or high-density polyethylene bottles, you can take the full range of clamshells, yogurt cups, all of that material is recyclable, and there is a demand for it. And we're really, one of the problems in the United States is right now is we have way over capacity of plastics reclamation capacity, which all the plastics are going to a intermediate processing step where they're being debaled, ground, washed, flaked, and pelletized. And that we have so much extra capacity in the United States that they're all screaming for material. So there's a real demand in the United States for more plastics especially.
And that doesn't mean that no material goes overseas.
Right.
It just means that there's plenty of demand right here in the United States.
Right.
There's way more demand.
So this one always comes up, which is it's just another tax. And I was the chairman of the Board of Selectmen of my town for a number of years until I wisely got off that. And I think it's fair to say, and I think that everyone that we've tried to implement it where this is an issue has asked us, could we give you a discount? Can we somehow show your household that you're going to save the same amount as you pay? And basically our position is you really can't do that. It's too difficult to do that. And I think the better arguments are that every municipality in the United States is faced with lots of pressure on the tax rate. School prices are going up, healthcare is going up. You're facing here in on the Cape, you are potentially facing groundwater issues in the future, and you certainly are facing stormwater discharge issues. As I said, we said earlier, We're involved in an international task force on marine plastic pollution, and EPA is really looking closely at requiring a separation of stormwater and sewer, and then a lot better treatment of stormwater discharges from runoff, because for one reason, for plastics being discharged in the marine environment. And so all of these are additional costs that every municipality faces, and one of the easiest services to get off of the property tax and put on a user fee basis is garbage. It's really an easy one to move from property tax to a user fee basis. And so the argument that it's just another tax, yes, it is a fee, and yes, you are going to pay it, and probably your property tax is not going to go down because there's lots of other pressures on the property tax, but ultimately, it's going to help you control your costs because it's a cost that doesn't need to be on the property tax. And so I think that that is a better argument than the argument that somehow you're going to see a property tax reduction, because it's probably not going to occur in most cases. The other argument that often occurs is that, and people don't think of this, is that essentially putting household garbage on the property tax essentially is a tax on businesses, because businesses don't get free garbage collection in most municipalities. And so what is happening is that you're transferring the cost of household garbage collection and disposal. Part of that cost is being transferred to businesses. And so if you're interested in helping support local businesses on the Cape, then taking trash off of the property tax is one way to reduce commercial property tax rates, which are quite high. And one of the things in Concord, New Hampshire, the Chamber of Commerce became one of the big advocates for promoting pay-as-you-throw in Concord, because they saw the value of moving the household trash off of the property tax because of the savings for businesses in the municipality. So low-income, elderly, or large family households, we talked a little bit before about the provision of small bags or small carts as a way to reduce the costs associated with low-income households. Also, the fact that a lot, as Natalie pointed out, about 50% of what's being thrown away on the Cape is actually recyclable or compostable. So if you are a family and you're worried about what the impact is going to be, you can point out that it's not that hard to increase the amount of material that you divert away from garbage and put into a recycling facility. And I'd like to just dispel this myth that this is going to cost a household $600 or $700 a year. Even a large family, and we sort a lot of garbage, even a large family does not typically generate more than 2 32- or 35- gallon bags of garbage a week. So if you have a large family and you are generating 2 32-gallon garbage bags per week, that's $4 a week, $16 a month, or $192 a year. That's not $600, that's $192 a year. If you are careful and you look at the amount of garbage that you're actually could be recycling, that you're throwing away in your garbage bag, you could cut that in half. You could be down to $2 a week instead of $4 a week, or under $100 a year for garbage collection and disposal. So
plus your sticker.
What's that?
Plus
your sticker. Right.
And communities that are do have programs and are very concerned about low income, there are exemptions. You come in and you file something and you get your bags or your punch cards free.
Right. There are in New Hampshire, and I don't know, and there's people in this room who probably know, but I don't, because I don't live in Massachusetts, but in New Hampshire, once it goes to a pay-as-you-throw pricing system, it becomes part of the utility. If you are a low-income household, you can get help with your utility bills. You can get help with pay-as-you-throw as part of that utility. So there are legal ways to subsidize low-income households. The other thing that you can do is you can make the first garbage can free, and then you can charge extra for the remaining part. So For example, Brockton, which is a very low-income community.
A little easier to do at the curb. But.
Right. Has one free 32-gallon can a week, and then you buy pay-as-you-throw bags for the rest of it. So that's a way to say, all right, we recognize that low-income households have problems. We'll give you what we would consider to be a reasonable amount of garbage disposal for free each week, but you'll pay for the additional amount, and that reduces your total impact.
And that's the idea behind the 32-gallon cart that MassDEP has grants.
So the drop-off version of that would be maybe when you get your sticker, you get a certain number of bags.
One bag per day.
Yeah.
Right. Buy three, get four.
You have a question?
Wellfleet does offer free bags to low-income people. It's administered by the Health and Conservation Agent. And since we started December 1st, there have been 8 people that have gone in to request assistance and free bags.
Just to add to that, when I talked to the health agent, none of those people were families with small children, who are often brought up to us as, this is hurting the families with small children who have diapers, and they're going to have to stuff the diapers in, and you know they're going to be using 4 or 5 bags a week. None of them have come and asked for this.
Right, and I mean, my youngest son surprised us with a grandson, and they decided that cloth diapers made a lot of sense when they started buying the diapers. Yeah. It's not the cost of disposing of the diapers, it's the cost of purchasing the disposable diapers is the real cost. So it's an argument that can be made that yes, you're gonna have to spend money on the disposal, but go into the store and price what it costs to buy the disposable diapers.
I think that's an uphill battle.
But garbage is a cost in relation to other costs, such as cable TV bills or internet charges, is pretty small on a monthly basis.
Right.
I think that's the other thing just to keep in mind.
But again, the primary point that we're making is that throwing around numbers that it's $500 to $700 a year and it's really going to hurt low-income households, that really is not the case. If you look at what a typical household sets out on the curb or brings to a transfer station each week, it really is about 32 gallons. So you for a standard household, a 4-person household, if you are at all careful with recycling and if you manage your yard waste in some way other than throwing it all away, your average amount of waste that you're going to be throwing away is about 32 gallons a week. One of the issues that is important to low-income houses, and we've done a lot of work in Boston on this, and we're now doing work in Hartford, Connecticut, which has a lot of low-income households, is bulky waste, because they do end up with a lot of older furniture, poorly made furniture. There's a lot of rental units where people move in and out. And one of the ways to solve that problem, and Middletown, Rhode Island has done this, and a lot of other municipalities are doing it, are to provide amnesty days. Essentially say 2 or 3 times a year, maybe it's 4 times a year, there's a roll-off at the transfer station. And if you're a resident of the town, you can bring in your bulky waste at no cost. So even if you're charging for bulky waste for the rest of the year, you can say, listen, if you can't afford to get rid of that mattress, if you can store it for a couple months, you can bring it for free and we'll dispose of it. So amnesty days for bulky waste have been a really popular way to provide an outlet for low-income households that have bulky waste and can't afford to pay to have it removed as an alternative. But one of the issues with bulky waste, and we see this all the time, is that free bulky waste is an invitation for contractors and owners of rental property to essentially dispose of material at your town's expense. And that happens all over the place. And one of the problems is that when you move to a bulky waste fee, the amount of bulky waste gets cut dramatically because that invitation goes away. And that is a cost that municipalities face, and it's a cost that does disappear when you get contractors and rental owners off of the free disposal that you're actually providing to them. Gentrification, I know that's an issue. It's not just an issue on the Cape, believe me. It's an issue in our municipalities in Vermont. Over 50% of the property owners in my municipality don't live there. They own very expensive property. It's a very famous horse country town. And we are very worried about gentrification. But I think it's fair to say that a SMART program is not going to hurt or help gentrification very much at all. You're not driving small families out of town because they have to pay $2 or $4 per week for garbage collection. There are the costs associated with families trying to buy a property on the Cape or a property in a nice place in Vermont have almost nothing to do with whether they have to pay for garbage disposal or not, quite frankly. And so I think it's an argument that gets raised, but I think that it is not a fair argument. I think if you keep coming back to how little garbage people really generate and how much it really is going to cost them, the average pay-as-you-throw bag is $2, I think, in Massachusetts. You can make it a buck. You can cut it in half. And you will have slightly less incentive to recycle than if it's at $2, but you will still have a SMART program or as a pay-as-you-throw program, and people will start thinking about the amount of waste that they generate and will start thinking about putting stuff in a recycling bag or composting it. So there are ways to price pay-as-you-throw pricing so that it doesn't price out low-income households or doesn't price out large small families that have children. But I don't think it's a real issue.
But isn't that conventionalism? You want the cost of the sticker to cover your fixed cost, the cost of the bag to cover your tipping fee that, within some range?
I would say that that's a convenient way to do it, but you can price your sticker and your pay-as-you-throw bag any way that you want. And so we typically will do a kind of a enterprise account and then ask the municipality what they want to do, how do they want to price it, what do they think is a fair price. And it's more about what's a fair price that you think is manageable for the community. There are some communities who want to put the entire cost of garbage collection and disposal on pay as a throw bag. And in that case, you're probably looking at between $2.50 and $3.50 per bag if you cover all your costs. But many, many communities, especially ones that are just implementing it, start with much lower pay-as-you-throw bags. I go back to Worcester. That was the only way that Worcester was able to implement it, was by having low enough prices on their bags so that they could show that low-income and large families were not going to be significantly impacted. And even with those low prices, Worcester has relatively high recycling rates and relatively low disposal rates. So it's more of the fact that there is a price rather than that the price is $4 as opposed to $1.50.
But what does Worcester charge?
What's that?
What does Worcester charge?
They're I believe that they are at $1.50 for a 32-gallon bag now, and they're at 75 cents for a 12-gallon or 20-gallon bag. And so they've kept their lower bags quite low on purpose as a way to reduce costs. And the other benefit of that, and we talked earlier about that, is you can go in and buy, if you're a low-income household, a small sleeve of 75-cent bags, and you don't have a large upfront cost associated with doing it. So that has kept Worcester's small bags relatively inexpensive, is that word.
But for example, if you want to think about it as $100 a ton, disposal and transfer costs from the transfer station, and you think about that's a nickel a pound, right? And then you think about 25 pounds in a bag, that's $1.25 for that disposal cost, the haul and the tip fee.
So that's a reasonable idea in terms of what you might charge. So, I guess the main point we're trying to make is we understand gentrification, we understand low-income issues, we do deal with them, and it's the price signal that there is a cost associated with disposal that's probably more important than the charge that you make on it. And once you implement pay-as-you-throw pricing, you can always go back and review it. We typically don't see municipalities raise their pay-as-you-throw bag prices very often. I would say whatever you implement, you're probably going to keep it at that price for 3 to 5 years because it's another fee that then the select board or the council has to deal with. So Whatever you said it is, that's probably what it's going to be.
I just wanted to say, I mean, I live in a town that is a mixed demographic, Heartland, Vermont. It's $4 a punch, and that's what we have to pay.
And the other issue is, if you're worried about gentrification, then put more of it on, keep a substantial amount on the property tax, okay? A buck a bag is not going to cover all of your costs, so keep the rest of it on the property tax if that's a worry to you. That's what Worcester does, that's what Brockton does, that's what a lot of low-income municipalities do, is they keep a certain amount on the property tax, but they have a charge for the bags or for the punch cards as well. And then, so you really have three options. One is subsidize part of it through the property tax. The second is the sticker, you know, so that if you're coming to the transfer station, you have to buy a sticker once a year, it's 50 bucks or whatever it is. And then the third is the pay-as-you-throw pricing or the smart pricing for every bag that you dispose of. So you can take those three revenue sources and decide how much to put on each one of those revenue sources as a way to address these issues.
Yeah, just by way of observation, Ken Harrington came in from Wellfleet. We sell our bags and sleeves of five. The large ones are a buck and a half. The small 10-pound ones are 50 cents. So it runs about $120 a ton for, you know, enough bags to make up a ton of stuff. That covers our tipping fees, but it doesn't cover the fact that you've also got three guys working there, and you've got capital costs and equipment replacement costs and scales and concrete pads. So it's not a moneymaker, but we have priced it so that the cost is low enough so that if I dared make the argument, I could make the argument that we're talking about a latte at Starbucks here. I'm not sure I'm going there, but
I've tried it before. It's never worked very well.
Well, okay. Well, my instincts are good, I guess.
But you're totally right, and so that's why we say if you were to try to price all of your costs, you would be up at $3 or $4 a bag. And there are plenty of municipalities who price it that way, just as they price the entire cost of providing a gallon of water, or the entire cost of disposing of a gallon of wastewater at the household level, and the utility prices the entire cost of providing a kilowatt of electricity to the house, and people pay that. We work in a lot of really poor countries. I did a lot of work in Tajikistan, for example, where people have no money. And one of the arguments, and as a consequence, they have no infrastructure, and garbage is everywhere. It's in the streets, it's everywhere. And one of the things we've learned from a lot of these countries where we've done what we call willingness to pay surveys is that most households, even very low-income households, recognize the value of some infrastructure to pick up their garbage, recognize the value of having a recycling program, and are willing to pay something to support the infrastructure. And I don't think that it's any different here. Almost every household, despite a lot of arguments at a select board meeting about why it's a horrible thing to do, most people do inherently recognize that garbage is a service that shouldn't be free. And so I think you have to make those arguments. I think
one more question on that.
Don't you think the larger picture here is overcoming behavior? In other words, people have been doing things one way, and it's very hard for them sometimes to think about changing. So you have to bring to them all of the methods or arguments for how it can happen and not be so, not a cost problem, but onerous in terms of the efforts they have to make to do it.
Yes, and in all of the places where they have had success. I mean, you don't find that many places where they change to a unit-based pricing program and then they go back. You know, maybe you can think of some because those are the same examples that come up again and again and again, okay? But in most cases, these 7,500, you know, or maybe it's, I don't know what the number is now, those programs are still around.
And I think the other point is that you make, which is well taken, is that almost never does a select board or a city council do this in the dark or in one vote. The ones that are successful almost always go through a very long public conversation. about it and allow for these types of conversations to be out there and to have this type of conversation. And that we're the famous, you know, the saying that the financial industry is you don't want to blow up a balloon more than once. Well, that's kind of the way it is with pay-as-you-throw. Your best shot is to try to get the conversation all out there, build an argument for it, find support for it. We do focus groups in municipalities where we'll go do neighborhood focus groups, we'll find out what the issues are, we'll try to find advocates for pay-as-you-throw, and then have those advocates come to the meetings. In the case of Concord, New Hampshire, they actually had to extend, they have a rule that they're not allowed to go after midnight. We were still there at 1:30 in the morning before they voted. They won the vote, but it took a lot of advocates coming to that city council meeting that night, and some environmental groups, the Chamber of Commerce, some people who had originally thought it was a bad idea who changed their mind, and those people being in the room and saying we support this was really helpful for the city council to hear rather than just the people that were opposed. And change is always hard. And so if you, and once it started, there were, you know, nasty letters to the editor, there are people saying, you know, this is a horrible thing. 3 to 4 months after pay-as-you-throw program starts, almost always those letters go away, and most people just get used to it, and it becomes a fact of life. But it is, for a lot of people in this room, it is a difficult political process. There's no question about it, but it also is, and Natalie and I can say this from 30 years of experience, the most effective way to drive recycling and composting and to drive waste down is to have a charge for garbage. There's nothing else that is quite as effective as charging something for every bag of garbage.
A physical charge.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I just want to make a comment on the political process, because we went through it for about 3 years in Wellesley. And many of the objections that have been voiced in this room and thoughts that have been, that most of us have thought about, will be brought up again by people and in a large group, and it's going to sound like the first time. And just because I've absorbed the objection and satisfied it in my own mind doesn't mean that everybody out there has. So you really need to write down all of the objections that you're hearing and prepare an answer for it and get that out there in frequently asked questions. And then also be prepared when you hear that objection in, you know, verbally in a forum to be able to answer it, because someone coming forward with an objection that 15 or 20 other people haven't heard, they're going to go, oh, I hadn't thought about that. You need to have the answer on that thing right away. And otherwise, it just spirals down into, well, let's just say there was a lot of misinformation associated with people that were concerned about this. And you need to nip it in the bud without being viewed as someone who is crass or nasty or condescending. Yeah, if you want the words floated about as you go through the process.
You're making a really good point, and I think that the whole public education, you're totally right. A lot of people raise issues that have been raised 100 times before, but for that person, it's a brand new issue. They have to have that answer. One of the reasons that Natalie and I get hired by municipalities is to go into these meetings and be there to answer all of those questions, because we've seen them in so many places. So we got completely beat up in Middletown.
Or to take the egg.
The public works director at the end of the meeting in Middletown said, you're not in Kansas anymore. And he was totally right. Rhode Island's a tough state. And we got a lot of grief, but we were there to take a lot of that grief off of the town council in Middletown before that vote. But you're right, you have to do, and that's why this slideshow is available. We try to answer as many of these issues. We are available to provide essentially free help to municipalities.
Through the Mass Recycling Challenge.
As is Dave Quinn on the Cape, so that you can have people come and answer these questions at your municipality. So if you want to have a public meeting, or if you want to have people come and get a chance to ask all these questions at your municipality, you've got resources in this room that are going to be available for the next year that will come to your municipality and help answer these questions, but we'll also provide you with the slides and any information you want in the meantime. So illegal dumping is often viewed as a significant issue.
And we're running over noon, we'll try and wrap this up in about 7 minutes. Is that acceptable to everyone? And then we're available after that.
Illegal dumping is often raised as a huge issue, but there have been national studies by EPA on the actual impacts of illegal dumping associated with charging for garbage, and it is really not a significant issue in almost every municipality where pay-as-you-throw is implemented. There are two reasons for that. One is it's relatively easy to enforce against illegal dumping, and what many municipalities do if they have a concern about it is that they will pull municipal workers off of other tasks for the first month or two to do additional enforcement. So they will look for places where illegal dumping is occurring. They will cite people. They will make sure that that citation gets in the newspaper. And it doesn't take very many citations. And most people who illegal dump, it's amazing, they almost always leave an address. And so it's not very hard to find it.
Yeah. Well, my husband just did one. We had dumping on our property, so he called the person up.
And so it as much as it gets raised as, you know, you're going to have this huge illegal dumping problem, it is not much of a problem. What is more of a problem is that businesses with dumpsters will have extra household garbage in them unless they lock them. So one of the ways to deal with that issue is to make sure that the garbage companies talk to businesses about the fact that they can provide locks for dumpsters so that that's not an issue. That issue again goes away. Much of the kind of impetus for illegal dumping comes from people who are really angry when the program first starts. And so in the first several months, if you're going to have a problem, that's when you're going to have it. And if you enforce against it or lock against it early on, those problems tend to go away fairly quickly. But so you need to recognize them as a potential problem, but they're not a long-term problem.
I just want to build on your statement for a second. Wellfleet has 80 trash cans scattered around. Most of them were seasonal, off beaches, ponds, marina, et cetera. And last August, before we implemented pay-as-you-throw, someone took a photograph and published it online of a trash can down at one of our beaches. It's a single trash can. And then there were 10 yards of trash piled up by it, you know, in August. And that illegal dumping, whether it's household trash or beach trash or whatever you want to call it, goes on now. And those people that do that are going to be here after you implement pay as you throw. So what you really need to measure is the change in illegal dumping. Of course, you have to recognize that it goes on now. You have to let everyone know that it goes on now. So in the first month when it happens and somebody takes a photograph of that, you know, it's not because of pay as you throw. It's just hasn't changed.
I'm really glad you brought that up, because that's very important to note. Do you already have illegal dumping as a problem in your community? Okay. Maybe you already do, then it's a problem, and how do you deal with it now? Maybe you're not dealing with it. If you don't have it, the likelihood that you're going to all of a sudden have it just because of pay-as-you-throw is probably not high. I guess MassDEP survey said 18 out of 136 smart programs reported any illegal dumping problem. That's not a really high number.
Yeah, from the DPW directors I've spoken with, most of them in beach communities down here seem to be of the opinion that the trash they're picking up at the beaches is probably more than 50% household trash now, and always has been.
That's certainly the case. You know, wherever sorting has been done of public space containers, and we did the public space recycling program for the National Mall in Washington, D.C., and we unfortunately had to sort their garbage before we started the program. That was the case there as well. There was a lot of household waste.
This is a slightly different sort of issue, but it might be more specific to Falmouth. We have curbside pickup right now, and people put out bins with the recyclable component in it, the plastic, the glass, the metal, and then another bin with the paper. I'm told, and I don't have the statistics to back this up, that we have a fairly high recycle rate already. I would contend that the amount of trash in any given community doesn't change by implementing the bag system, but it shifts how much of it is recycled versus how much goes someplace else. If we're in a community already that's perceived to have a high recycle rate, there's not a lot of impetus or groundswell to go implement it because, you know, you cite statistics of savings, but people are going to come back and say, well, because we're already at such a high rate of recycle, our savings will be so small, why go through this change? Now, I'll sit here and say, any increase in the recycle is a good thing, but it seems like an uphill battle in the conversation at that point. And, Do you have suggestions on how to handle that one?
Yeah, actually, yes, because that's our bread and butter is what we call recovery rates studies, which is we're one of the few companies in the country that actually does them. We look at the capture rate or the recovery rate of different materials. And what we see is even in high recycling communities, probably somewhere, you're only getting somewhere between 50 and 60% of the recycling in your recycling bin. The rest is going in the garbage. And a pay-as-you-throw or a smart program almost always will drive that up to 75%.
Because even though they have their bin out, doesn't mean they have every paper and bottle and can that could be recycled in that bin. Some of it ends up in the trash.
We have we've heard the same argument in Dennis somewhat with a recycling grid already. So we at DPW just take out some of the trash, throw it into the trash bins, cut them open. 50% of it can be recycled. So this is a Dennis answer to a Dennis solution just by looking. Now, it wasn't a huge sample, but it was a sample. Like, you make it as big as you want to. So whatever you're recycling already, for what's going in that 4,000 tons that Dennis ships off to at the moment, CMS, okay? Half of that stuff can be recycled. And you can apply it right to your own town if you just look at it.
Yeah. And I think the other thing is that there is the yard waste component that might be diverted or left on site or treated differently. And then there's the reuse or bulky waste component. There's a lot of different components of the waste stream. And once you're paying per unit, you start to treat some of those things differently and think about diverting them from trash.
And changing the body habits, too.
Right.
Yeah, just, I'm sorry for speaking up so much.
Fine.
It's the coffee that got me going.
All of us.
We have 3 months worth of statistics in Wellfleet, and it's only 3 months. Okay, so it's just starting, and we're a much smaller town than many of you. We increased our recycling 63%. I don't think that's going to hold. It's again a very small sample size, but we increased it by 36 tons. We decreased our municipal solid waste by 36%. So, you know, you got to understand the tonnage as well as the percentages. We decreased our municipal solid waste by 163 tons, increased our recycling only by 36. So it's not a net zero arrangement. I looked at the statistics that Sandwich published. For every 9.5 tons that they decreased their municipal solid waste, they increased their recycling by 1 ton, which is a huge arrangement. I had a lot of data from Duxbury when we went through this. For every 6.5 tons that Duxbury reduced their municipal solid waste, they increased their recycling by 1 ton. So some of it's going into composting. Some of it should have gone to the brush pile or wherever and had gone over the yard, you know, over the dumpster, and now it's going back to the brush pile. Some is avoidance, and you know, some of it's going to probably to the town of Easton instead of Wellfleet right now. So thank you for doing that for us. But just because you decrease your municipal solid waste doesn't mean you're going to increase your recycling by that same amount.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, thank you for bringing that up.
Just a question, how are you getting those numbers? Are you using that from last year's figures, what you got in last month?
Year on year for the month.
Same exact time period.
Okay. Yeah.
One of the things you're going to see on the Cape is that as municipalities implement pay-as-you-throw pricing or smart pricing, pressure on the adjoining municipalities to implement unit-based pricing is going to go up because that is going to be a relief valve for people who don't like unit-based pricing. And so we've seen it in municipalities that are surrounded by unit-based pricing municipalities. They implement unit-based pricing basically as protection. So that it's a level playing field, that people don't have a free place to put material. So unfortunately for those of you who haven't, you're going to start seeing more pressure to do so because of the municipalities around you that have negative base.
So you should all do it together.
You're welcome to that.
We want to cover one more, and then we'll wrap it up. Political risk.
Right.
We've talked about this, but...
I don't know what the answer to this is, other than what we said before, which is that you really are better off, and I think you guys and women all know this probably as well as we do, but spending the time to educate people, making sure that you have forums where people can ask all these questions, can raise all these issues that you know in your mind and have an answer, and getting those answers out in every way that you can is really helpful, and making sure that when you finally do have a vote, that probably you should have counted, you've counted your votes before the night of the meeting.
And one thing, an FAQ, for example, which some of you probably have all done, frequently asked questions, to be sure you have all of those out with really good answers.
Right.
That's certainly something that DSM, SDP can help you with.
Right. We and Dave are available to address any of the issues that come up, and if an issue comes up and you haven't heard that issue before, there's another municipality out there who's had to deal with that, and we can give you an answer.
Can I just offer up to what next steps might be, because I see everyone packing up. You know, the thing about smart pricing that's so important that we've talked about today is when you get into that decision-making process, it's nice to have others besides the townsfolks there to help answer all the questions. And so, in addition to Dave, we also have technical assistance available from DSM. And so loop in with them, whether it's coming to a town meeting or helping you with your analysis, helping you with your frequently asked questions or what to do when. Both if you're doing pay-as-you-throw, but if you've just done pay-as-you-throw, and there's other issues coming up, especially on the recycling side. Ted and Natalie are phenomenal at that too. So helping you figure out the cost system or the different ways to price it out, coming up with the answers, coming to meetings, those are all things. It's not just the workshop today, which has been terrific, but there can be follow-up. So work through Dave, work with DSM. They're here for this year. They're funded for this year to help you. So please take advantage of it, because today probably answered a lot of questions. But then when you go back and you're really starting to dive into what does it really mean, what might it really cost, or how can we structure this financially, that's where that expertise is available to you.
And thank you everyone for coming. And we're sorry we're running late, but there's nothing worse than doing a presentation and have everyone looking at you and not asking questions. So I much prefer this type of interactive meeting. We can wrap it up now. If anyone wants to stay and ask questions, Natalie and I aren't going anywhere for a while. We're happy to answer
it's
questions.
It's warmer down here.